This is your brother G-Con. I just want to give a shout out to Ask the Streets Media and peace and blessings to y'all.
Ask the Streets.
I like that one.
Conscious, yes, sir. What's going on with you, baby?
Man, peace to the family out there, man. Glad to be here. I'm in Chicago with these brothers.
Chicago on the south side, that is.
Like
hey, well, you know, I guess I'll go get right into it, man. I wanted to talk about the church. And the churches in the black community. We got so many churches in the black community. And it seems like the community is still in written and it is just towed out, right? And then a lot of the people who go to those churches, their children seem to be going to jail. They the ones in jail. What's going on, man? Is this program not working? What's going on?
I think that we definitely got to make sure that, you know, when we're dealing with the church, that we, you know, get the people. First of all, they got to hear the message. You know, that's the first thing.
Okay.
You know, you hear the message, you do what the book is saying, you know, for a moral thing. Now, what the church is basically doing for us financially is where the problem is at. You know, financially, we need to take this money, put it back in the community, you know, and deal with some industrial things, you know, and also create certain things to make people outside of the community want to buy what we're dealing with to generate that money in the community. Okay. So we're not doing it. We have to industrialize in the community, build factories where we can do these things in the community. We raise so much money, that's what we should do. And we're not doing that. We're basically generating this money and it's going from the church and it's going right back out the door.
Well, who getting this money though? So when you talk about tithes and offering in the church, who gets that money? Do the archbishop get the money? Who gets this money?
Well, most of the time, as you can see, the pastors and those that's working behind the thing, especially the pastors, are getting the money. Now, if it's a church that's doing what they should be doing, which we can't really find that many these days, then, you know, they're going to put the money either in the community to where they're going to build like recreation centers and stuff like that, or either schools, you know, where people can learn that, or they're all the community basically. Now, you know, we have it now to where, you know, the pastors are taking the money and they doing what they need to do with the money and the people ain't benefiting from it.
Right.
So that's the problem with that.
And that's the problem with that. And the people seem to just dogmatically or religiously continue to deal with these type of pastors who are doing this. What is this, a fear thing that they doing? Are they doing this out of fear? Afraid to go to hell? What's going on with that? Why they continue to do this? And they see, well, I don't know if they see it or not, but it appears that this ain't working.
Right. Like I said, I think that for the most part, it's not working because we're not applying. Like, if you look into the Bible, these people were industrial people. They dealt with agriculture.
Okay.
So they knew the science behind produce and producing things within their communities, how to fertilize the ground, you know, when the season to plant. So these people were industrializing their communities, and that's not happening in the church. You know, so I think that's the whole thing. What's going on now is people have got selfish. People, you know, just doing their own thing now.
Right. So it's like there's a lot of black folks. Like, okay, whether you like the church or not, or whether you like social media, a lot of black folks are in these places.
Right.
Black folks is in the church. Black folks are on social media. Is this something against the church having or going through an economical teaching on one Sunday or something, or political teaching on how to deal with politics in the city or whatever? Is it something going? Is it something the church can't do? Is it some they hand tied or something behind their back?
Well, most churches should teach that.
I like that.
You know, dealing with economics.
Okay.
You know, dealing with, you know, certain things on how to produce, you know, so where they can circulate money. Kingdom cash flow is what they would call it.
Okay.
It's got to the point now to where people are so consumed with what's going on around them, it's just a self thing now. You know, it's like, it's just about bless my four and no more. You know, how I can benefit instead of trying to lift somebody up you know, or sponsor somebody, or they got these ideals, but they may not have the money, but they got an ideal to where you can put the money behind them and generate some type of commerce or something like that. So I think that the pastors, man, you know, the churches that I've attended, they usually teach on finances.
Okay.
They usually teach on how to get your debt together. So where the money actually goes, what they should be doing, what it is, and sometimes the churches that are doing what they should be doing, they send money more so like Wednesdays is for admissions. Mm-hmm. Missionary work. Okay. Where they use missionary work, where they send that money over there, and then they finance or help those people out, build them wells and stuff like that, and you know, drinking water and food. That's what a church should be doing. Usually Wednesday should be given up to that day. That's not happening anymore. That's not happening anymore. People are taking that money and trying to expand the church and get more people in the church. And then you see the pastor coming up. The community is dirty, but you got this nice church in the community. But your community is suffering bad. You know, people still need to be fed and,
right,
you know, no recreation centers or nothing like that.
So, do you think the church need help, or is the church like, do the church, is God on the side of the church where they don't really need help from nobody who not per se religious or not don't believe the same thing?
I think that they need help in you know, psychologically in their mindset for us, like, you know, you not doing the right thing. You need to do the right thing. You know. You know, God, the Bible is simple. We can see to where it says that in the Bible concerning what a person should, how, you know, they should live, you know, how they should eat. And if you want to do those things, then you got to be able to, you know, produce those things. And so I think that that's something that these guys are not doing. And they definitely need some type of help. You know, people are preaching or teaching the prosperity gospel,
right,
but it's not really benefiting the people. It's benefiting those who are teaching these things.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, you get his prayer. We'll send his prayer cloth to you, and this. So it's mocking
Jesus.
It's mocking really what the Bible is trying to convey.
Right.
You know, these people in the Bible, they set up a government. Excuse me. They had agriculture. You know, they had different sciences, and they was doing business with the people that was round about them, and so they was off the port in Jerusalem or wherever they was, but you know, it was off the port, so they knew how to do business.
Okay.
You know, the church ain't got no interaction with the outside world on how business work, and so they need to be taught that.
The people of the church definitely need to be taught that. I do believe that. And it's as far as morally, When you talk about different type of businesses, are there businesses that the church wouldn't go into even though it's making a lot of money? Like for instance, you got a lot of members in that congregation that might drink alcohol from time to time. They might not get drunk, but they still might enjoy a drink or something. So they visit liquor stores. Is that like against the rules, or is it against morality?
No, not actually, because a person, you know, could sit back and they might say, well, I want to have me a drink, you know what I'm saying? I want some wine or whatever the case may be. You know, right. And I think that it's really about, you know that when you drink wine, you know you're up under the influence, so just relax. Mm-hmm. You know, don't get out here and get to doing things like you driving around and you drinking, you know what I'm saying? Stuff like that. Just relax in your own space and set your boundaries, you know? And I think that there's nothing wrong with that, you know? I'm not saying go out there and go get a lemonade jug and just go to town, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
none of that, but you know, so all of that is cool, you know. I'm not saying to go out there and get you pop some Molly or something like that, because we know there's consequences behind it, but to get you a little drink, you get off of work, laid back, you wind it down. Also, wine is also good for your blood pressure. It helps you with your blood pressure, it helps you take some of the tension up off you. So those things are cool, you know, but mm-hmm. You know, there's nothing with that. As far as morality,
I'm saying, like, when I was saying, like, that's a thriving business in the black community. And that's what I'm saying. Could the church own a liquor store? Is that like a bad look for a church, or is that like a smart move, maybe?
I don't think a church should own a liquor store.
Okay.
Matter of fact, not only that, I think that as black people, we really should get the liquor stores out of our our communities.
At least some of them.
Right. Because what's happening is people are overdoing it now. They get too drunk now. You know what I'm saying? So they get sloppy drunk. So and it's all right to get you a little swig now and then or whatever, get on, you relaxing. But it's getting to the point where now they're in front of the liquor store, drinking that up, and then going back in and go get something else. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, they say liquor hit like crack, man. After a while, alcoholism, it turned into a bad thing.
Right, and that's the thing, man. Is just doing things, having a balance to it. You know, like it's just you got to have a balance thing. I don't think we should own any liquor stores until we learn how to control ourselves. You know, okay. We in the vineyard too much already. You know.
Yeah. But I mean, like, cause I'm thinking, like, what type of business? Cause when you think about the community, you gotta think of you gotta be realistic to it, right? And so you gotta say, well, what's selling around here? What are people buying over here? And then, you know, sometimes people buy, you know, it's just a little, you know, I don't.
Right.
That's a little stretch to have a church out of liquor store, right? But you know what I'm saying? It's just the business that's thriving in the black community. Right. Unfortunately. Between liquor stores and Harold's Chicken, I ain't never seen anyone when I closed down in Chicago.
Right.
On the south side, literally. Yeah, Harold's Chicken, that was open when I was a baby, still open. Unless the building was condemned. Yeah, or condemned, or whatever.
I think that, you know, we need to start producing our own stuff, like far as like, even if it's dealing with cattle or herd or something like that.
I think
that.
That's big, man. Right. Having a product.
Then we can also not only have that to where we can have butchers and stuff like that, you know, and people how to handle the meat, you know, because what we're being sold in the grocery store, see, we can produce those things. We can produce our own toilet paper.
Right.
You know, people need to wipe that, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. You got to get down with that, you know?
That's so big. And that's the issue. When you mention that, so that's part of the big issue. We don't produce nothing.
Right.
I ain't gonna say nothing. I'm not aware of everything that we probably do produce, but the black race of North America don't really got nothing big that we produce that everybody know, oh, this black folks producing this and that's made and whatever.
Right.
Okay, so how do you feel about a relationship with Africa that we can get natural goods and material from? With a discount or whatever, maybe not a discount, but just a connection with Africa. Is that important for us to be able to produce things or not?
Yeah, I definitely think we need to be in relationship with them as well as the land. You know, they don't view us, you know, black people as them. Because I think that because our culture is a little bit, well, it's a lot different from theirs. So you gotta understand that these people don't view us just because we're black.
Are we African?
Yeah, I believe we're Africans.
Okay.
And I believe that we have African ancestry. Okay. And so we are black Americans. And what I mean by that is we are in America and we have American culture.
Right.
Whereas when we look at our ancestry, they come from Africa. So, you know, we're not native to the land.
So you don't think we was already here?
I think that there probably would have been some blacks here, but not a whole lot. I think that the people who was here was basically Asiatics or Mongoloids. And the reason why I say that is because where they would have came from, they was more closer, you know, to the... Then what we also find in, you know, the way they... How they dress in certain things, as far as, like, you know, with the feathers, clothing on, the feathers on their head. You know, we had Africa doing that too, but at the same time, the people in the East, we could find them with the tall hats on and stuff like that, on top of Mesopotamia. And then we see also the Nile Valley have a relationship with these people too, because they wearing the tall hats and different things. So I just think that...
The fez?
More so not like the fez, but the Dasharet, the desert hat. You see the Norma them got on, and then the southern and the northern cap. So these people got to share some type of relationship with each other, but for the most part, the people of the East would have traveled along the coast and would have came, you know, from Asia, out of Asia, came probably across the Bering Strait, and then they always traveled the coast. That's what you always do. You want to stay towards the coast. And I think that that's what they actually did.
So with the Moors, you don't believe that story then?
What about the Moors?
They saying they was already here. The president saw the law, Black's Law Dictionary, I guess. I'm not sure, 100% sure. I mean, they say it was already here.
They came here. They came here, but they came here a little later. But the native people that was already here, we gotta make sure that we don't.
So the Moors weren't the people that got captured here. That's what they were saying.
Yeah, no, it wasn't. Not at all.
And they said that was them, right?
Right, but when you look at the native people that was here, as far as the Aztec, and you begin to talk to their ancestors, I mean, the people who's now, and they know about their ancestors, they actually are telling blacks of America, because it's only us that's doing this, because we want to try to find where we could stem back to. So when you go talk to these people, and genetically also do genetics on it, and also linguistically, they tell you that they don't stop stealing their culture. We stop telling them that we them, because they not us, or we are not them. So we have to be careful we don't do the same thing that Eurocentrics done and go and take people's history. Mm-hmm. When we start dealing with having an Afrocentric perspective.
It's a thin line between that, right? Because this, I wonder that. That's a great thing you said. Are we taking people's history when we call ourselves Israelites, or when we call ourselves Moors, or when we call ourselves the Indians and shit like that, things like that of that nature? Are we taking people's history?
I think that sometimes, you know, we can do that. You know, we can do that. As far as the Moors was a, you know, you had blacks, you know what I'm saying? You had different people that was a part of this movement, and as far as I know. And so, you know, you can beat that, because, you know, but when you start dealing with other cultures of people, and they're saying that we're taking what's theirs, and they have the history and the culture behind it to prove that they are these people. Mm-hmm. Like, we look at the people with the big faces, big noses, what is the Olmecs? Yeah. You go to California, you go down a little bit south a little bit more, you can see that these Mesoamerican people was there, and they have these big noses, and
look like that, don't
they look like that. And, uh-huh. And so these people are not black. These people are actually what they call Asiatics, and so when you go farther back in that history, you can actually see, if you go to the east, you start seeing the same people with the same features in Asia, just a little bit farther east. Mm-hmm. And so we see these people with these features, like the Dravidians. The Dravidians is darker than me and you, but these people are not black though.
Right.
So, you know, and what I mean by that is African basically.
So do they have any African in them? Or is it just because of the place where they located on the equator, by the equator, that they get dark like that?
Yeah, I think it's by the equator, because we have what you call a skin chart. Mm-hmm. And that's something that the Amara squad had put out there, something that I had never seen that they put out there. I got to give them credit for that, you know, because when you look at the skin chart, you kind of see, as you go up higher, you get a little bit lighter. Now, most people might say, well, as you go down lower and you get towards the equator, you get darker, and as you know, you can start seeing within the skin chart these different colors. But for the most part, you know, they might say, well, what about the Eskimos? Well, mm-hmm. Well, look at the Eskimos' diet. What do they eat? They eat fish, so it has a vitamin D in it. So we see that what they expose to, what they eat, is what's gonna, you know, cause them to have this type of mutation to where they might, you know, keep that color. Or even white people, they might get lighter in color.
Well, I wouldn't even look at that as well. I'd just ask the question as to how long does this process take? Like, for instance, Black America been in America for about 400 to 500 years approximately, you know, maybe six. And we still getting dark skinned people that's coming out of the north. You know what I mean? Like Chicago, you know what I mean? So is that how long does this take? You know, you understand what I'm saying, based on that chart that they said that they had.
Right. Where they try to say, what they use is a biological clock, or what we call a molecular clock. And what it is is you can look at certain genetics to see how certain organisms change between one organism A or organism B. What is the change amount between those? And so they have that worked out to where they, and that's all based upon the geologic time scale are fossils. Mm-hmm. So these fossils in the ground, where they say came out of Africa, of these ape-like creatures, and so they look at the model change from where we at now, and that species or that organism, and say, well, this is the amount of time that this would have took for this to change. But that's just not really the case. Whatever you're working around, let's say if you're working around different type of metals, we understand white people was working around certain type of metals. It's gonna affect your color. It's gonna affect your genetics, dealing with your eyes, you know, and your hair also too. That's what we're starting to find out. People that work around these different type of metals are mining. It messes with their color. It causes a mutation within their chromosomes, and then when what happens is when the RNA read that DNA, it causes a copy error, and you know that's what happens to where you see that these people have these mutations on their chromosomes. It's not like us.
And then they pass it through their genes.
Yeah. So it's really something I think that is fast, because when we look at America right now, and since when we came here, or how long we've been here, 500 some years. You can, a black person can go and have sex with a white woman, and they child won't be black. Most people say it's the dominant gene, and it is the dominant gene, but when it comes for just notice, if you look around, you're gonna see a black person go have a white child, go get with a white woman, they have a child. The child is not black anymore. Like, as much as the child, is the child black, but the child is not black in color.
I guess you don't have, right. I'm thinking because some people in the constant community would say, if you got a white mom or a white father, you're not black. You know what I mean? And even though you identify as black, how you feel about that?
I think it's about, I think it's about genetics and more so culture.
Okay.
It's a culture thing. Like, you got, so when we look at the culture, We look at the color, and that's fine, but we can look at somebody that got a black father, but their mother white. You know what I'm saying? So this person, we know that more so if we say dominant, that their father's dominant, so they have that recessive gene. So we look at the child as being black, and so it is what your father is, so to speak. And that's how we classify, because that's how we've been taught to classify. But I think the overall it's really about culture for real. You know, if me and you speaking the same thing, then we can relate to each other. You know what I'm saying? Whether or not you're black or white, that's how it really should be.
So you're saying they basically got the option to identify as black or not?
Right. They, because
I guess that's fair.
And the reason why I say that is because you got black people that, because of a lack of communication, just because they don't get along, but they black.
Right.
So I think everything is about communication. It's about boundaries. So we have to look at that and take that into consideration. Just because this person ain't black doesn't mean that I can't interact with this person. If this person got the same mindset and speaking the same thing that I'm speaking culturally, then we can mix with that person. Now, relate to that person. That's what it's about. A lack of communication is what causes what we in today. You know what I'm saying? People just not communicating properly.
Now, when you mention other races, I know the Hebrews say that the white man is the devil. Do you believe that?
I believe, yes. I believe the white man is the devil.
Okay.
As well as I believe the black man is the devil.
I don't know. Now, explain to me what the devil is, then.
When you look at the word devil in the Bible, if anyone take that stance, we dealing with it from a biblical standpoint of what we view, what the Bible view as the devil, or what it say about being the devil. The devil means our Satan, our adversary, our accuser.
Okay.
So so when we look at that, we got people that's really accusing you or slandering you. It's against what you're trying to do. You know, so we say this is the devil, but also there is a definite article of a devil who we believe that is a entity, that is outside of man, that is a enemy of mankind within itself, according to the biblical text. And so I think that's the view that I hold is that when we dealing with the devil, there's a definite article of the devil, but also, when we look at the wordplay, people can be accusers or devils just as well.
Okay, so you're saying there's an actual devil, that entity that's a devil, and then people also can play the role
being a devil.
Okay, I get that. So anybody can be this.
Anybody, even including me.
So what about the God? Then can anybody be the God? Does that work the same way? Like, is there an entity that's God and then everybody else is God at the same time?
Right. Because what it is, there is a definite article when we talk about the Godhead. You know, there's as a Christian, we talk about distinct persons within the Godhead, but still the head of all the gods. So what that means is this is that you can share some things with God and be godly, but there's still something that's set right there that is God, and there is you also that's there. So you have to have the mindset of God to even be able to function in this world and for it to be like it needs to be. So I think that you can be looked at as the Bible says that this person is, God says, come and let us make man in our image and likeness. So you're in the image and likeness of God, but there is still something that is distinct about God on how he does things, or how he, how he created the world. So we have to understand and respect him in his house, basically. We view him as,
Okay. And so when you deal with the Bible, do you take the Bible literally or metaphorically or metaphysically? How do you take the Bible when you deal with the Bible?
I take the Bible as literal things and also as some figurative things. Okay. That's in the Bible. Either way, I think they are cohesive. In other words, I don't separate them. In other words, there are some things that's in the Bible that we see that are historical that we have to view and look at. And then there are some things that's in the Bible to where they are some figurative things.
Give me an example or something like that.
For instance, when I say a person, how can I say it? In the Bible, these guys are in the tabernacle. They make a tabernacle in the wilderness. And when they make a tabernacle, they're cooking and doing certain things like that, and shedding a lot of blood and stuff like that. And what this is a pattern or something figurative of something to come. And so what I mean by that is these people are not just having a cookout in the wilderness. All of these things mean something. And what it means is that covenant, because that's how the ancient cultures looked at it, viewed it, that they would part these pieces and each individual would walk through it and cut this covenant with each other. Whoever broke that covenant would be parted like those pieces. So these are contracts. So then what they're showing in the Bible is that someone who makes a mistake, right, and break that covenant, their blood can be shed or there can be a substitute to start. So when they're in this wilderness and they're cooking and doing stuff like that, they're basically pointing towards a ritual. They're partaking of a ritual, and the ritual is embedded, is a blood covenant or a covenant. So it's saying that whatever you do in life, you have to shed some type of blood. If you sin or if you don't follow instructions, blood will be shed. Well, this is a principle. If you,
that sounds pretty scary.
Right. If I'm in the household, right, and I'm making a mistake, right, my whole household has to give account for that.
Okay.
And it's sad to say, but that's just the way it is, because I'm the head of the household.
Right.
And you don't even have to be the head of the household. A child can do something, but it affects the whole household. So innocent blood is shed all the time behind whatever somebody do. So in the wilderness, they gave account for that, which is what they call a life for a life. In other words, if somebody was to do something that was not right, to substitute for that, they would shed animal blood.
Right.
But it was really figurative of what we
sacrifice.
Right. It was figurative of what Christ was going to do.
Understood.
So, like a ransom or something like that.
So you don't think the story of Christ was a figurative story?
I think it was historical.
That's literal.
I think that was his mission for mankind, was to be that substitute to restore man back to a spiritual and also a more so a physical state. What we call, and I think that's the whole thing.
Okay. All right. So Christ is Christ. Is that a title or is this one the name of the Son of God, and this is just specific to him, or can anybody be a Christ?
There was many of Christ, and what Christ means is just means to be anointed or to be Christos, to be smeared or rubbed on.
Okay.
And so anybody can be a Christ, but you know what I mean by that is you have to be anointed, like someone is anointed to be a priest. So they, what they would do, they would anoint this person with some type of oil or something. So there were many Christ, but there still is a Christ that is overall those other Christ. And that's where the Bible viewed it as, you know, this is the prophet, the king, and the priest that was to come. He holds all these three offices.
Okay. And so Christ is an ancient name. So would the apostles of today be a Christ? If they were back then, or would they be at different levels of anointing?
It depends on what they was anointed to do. Like most people are anointed a prophet or a priest. And so if that person was I would say they would be anointed. They would be a Christ. Because they was anointed. Yeah, they was anointed with the Spirit. And so that's what the oil really was dealing with. Is you go and you anoint somebody with some oil. But now in the New Testament, somebody's been anointed with the Spirit that was figurative of the oil. Right. So that's like one of the examples we look at. Being anointed with oil in the old days, something figurative, and then something literal of seeing this person actually been anointed with the Spirit.
Okay. Revelations. Black Jesus minister running this all day long. I should know this by heart, in fact. Because when he talked about Jesus being black, is Jesus a black man? Do you believe Jesus is black?
No, I don't think Jesus is black.
You don't think Jesus is black?
No, I don't think he was black. Right.
Ooh, Jesus. You finna start this. Right. You finna get it started, man.
Right.
Hold on. I'm gonna have to put this in the title, but for the clickbait or something like that. Jesus just said that Jesus Christ was not a black man.
Right.
Okay, so what's going on? Is Jesus Christ a white guy?
No, he's not white.
He Italian?
He looks like his people. He's as an Arab. Yeah, I think he was an Arab. Like most people might say, well, Christ went into Egypt and he hid down there because he was black. Well, in his time period, we know that the Nubians and all these people was pushed towards the south. So who was ruling that area at that time? We see the Ptolemaic Greeks is there at that time, and also we see that if I say Greek, that doesn't necessarily mean you're white, but
true.
We have to where these Arabic people, the same people we see today, was there today, you know what I'm saying?
Right. It's assumed that that they white, though when you say Greek.
Right, yeah, it's assumed that. So when we look at during this time, you would have had the Romans ruling almost around Northern Africa.
Right.
So the people who would have been there, Jesus would have been hiding among, was the people who are there today. And we look at 500 BC during that time, mm-hmm. and we start looking at Taharqa and all of them around 700, and these people had already been pushed towards the south.
So they was out of there
already. So you would have seen the same people today. So when you say,
you better get a couple of texts or something.
Right.
When
you say that this guy, like even when you look at the catacombs, I've seen people argue about, these people was black in the catacombs. Well, it was some black people among them, was black Christians. These people was of dark color. But bottom line, these people looked like Arabs. And they've been looking like that. You know what I'm saying? Because even when you look at the pictures in the catacombs, they dark colored people, but if you look at it, everything else around it is darkness as well. So that's how they was coloring with something. These people in catacombs, so they probably had only one thing to color with, a couple of things to make colors with. You know what I'm saying? So it's like, even when you start looking at Revelations, which I know you're going to get at that.
Right. Like Jesus gonna say that in the, right. That burning brass.
Right. And anybody that
did. Also say though. Oh, sorry.
Right. It's good. What'd it say?
Head white. So that revelation is an image. It's not really a literal image of how he was on the earth.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
But it do say head white. They missed that part.
Right.
I think
head was white, how you have a head that's white and feet that's brown.
I think they talk about the hair though, but that's why they look over that.
No, it say head.
Right, it say head, but I'm thinking
pull that up.
I'm thinking people thinking it because, see, when I hear it, it says, I'm imagining a head for the white hair. Mm-hmm. And so I guess I'm assuming that other people thinking like that too, because I would thought like that. But no, I didn't really.
Right.
That's deep though. That's heavy right there.
Right. And when you look at it, it says his eyes is red. Right.
Right. Like a weed smoking black.
Pull it up, man. We gotta pull it up because this is where we gotta look at it. It says his eyes is red. All
right.
And they look at it and they'll say, well, it says her as
wool.
And they go, oh, you got some kinky stuff. That's what they are. But really.
But he would have been a 30-year-old guy with
right.
Gray hair.
That's crazy. Look, when you think about it, I didn't even consider it like that. He wasn't a bit old, right? But
right. So what's it? What white hair represents in the ancient East is wisdom.
Mm-hmm.
So the whole thing is pointed towards wisdom. Why is his feet as it looked like it has been burnt in a furnace?
Right, burnt brass.
Burnt brass. Why is that? Because his steps. If you look at burnt brass, he's looked at as being as passing through something as being tried. As regular metals, this is what this is dealing with.
So you saying that's an analogy for saying that he been through something.
Yeah, and so his steps is ordered, and so Satan in the book, what we call the cherub in the book of Ezekiel, it says that he walked upon the coals of fire, or the stones of fire. So what it's saying is this guy whose feet is like this. His feet has been tried, like silver and gold. His works came out to be not no wood, stubble, or hay. So this is what this is dealing with.
And not to cut it off, but it says his head and his hairs were white like wool.
Right, okay.
So, you know,
what translation is that from?
The KJV.
Right, see?
So that's the one they use. So it says head, so. Like, I used to talk about that a lot, but it's what it say.
Right.
So if you use that, you know, like I say, it's just an image. It's just, it has meaning to it. It's not like how he actually
right.
on the earth.
It's a parable for it.
Yeah, it's basically like, you know, it's symbolic.
And it says his face was as the what? As the sun.
Yeah.
As,
not in this verse, but I know where you at.
Right,
but,
so right.
Like, his eyes were as the flame of fire. So it's as, it's like metaphors, you know?
Right. Yeah, I mean, I see it as metaphors all day. Yeah.
Now that's figurative. I should have used that for example. Yeah, that's figurative.
Right, yeah. But when you're talking to people like Black Jesus Minister, who like adamant about this, and the Black Madonna and Child, you know what I mean? What's right. that about being the Black Madonna and Child? And then, you know, is that, was Black Madonna?
Black Madonna was black.
Yeah, so who was black. That child?
Well, it's really deeper than that. Nimrod and his mother basically are Nimrod and his mother. She used to be called the Queen of Heaven. That's what she was called. They call us
Queen of Heaven.
Queen of Heaven. They call her Inanna, and the East, and Susa. I guess what they call her also. She may have been called Isis. Okay. So you got people with different tongues. This basically. Been pushed away from where they was, but they still have some type of memory of these ancient people who was their ancestors, and they venerate these people. So that's who the Black Madonna is. You know, she's and it comes from the Cush, who was Nimrod. I mean Cush, who was the father of Nimrod, who you know went backslid and cause the people to go into error, you know.
Okay.
So.
So when we talk about race, though, the Hebrews also claim that King James is a black man. How do you feel about that? Is King James a black man?
Man, I seen the pictures, and when I seen the pictures, King James is not black. That's his bottom line.
Is this a problem?
It's a problem, man. Like, let them tell it. Listen, Bruce Lee is an Israelite.
Okay, I'm not Bruce Lee. But I guess what I'm asking is a problem. If Jesus is not black and if King James is not black, is that a problem?
No, I don't think it's a problem. I think that King James had something to do with the Bible, not that he wrote it, but that he authorized it. In other words, if I go and write something and I'm in your state, it's just rules you got to go by. So he authorized it. He put his stamp on it and said, okay, we took this to him, let's get this authorized.
Okay.
So
do you follow the King James Bible?
Yeah, I follow. I use the King James, and I use also the Stone Tanakh.
Another okay, book. So the King James is not the ultimate Bible for you.
It will be the ultimate Bible. I'm going to teach from the King James out of anything else.
Okay, so like when you just said authorized, King James authorized. Who gave King James the authority to authorize the Bible?
King James. In other words, this is it.
I mean, but I guess the question I'm asking is, who gave this king the authority to authorize God's word?
In other words, this is what it is. It's like they look at this as the book as being like, if you go write a book right now. Mm-hmm. Well, if you go write a book, you have to go to a publisher or something like that. So back in the ancient times, this book is not only dealing, it's so important to where you got the Romans was dealing with Catholicism is banging on this book, and they get into an argument about this book, and you got King James, who was a king, and he probably not really more so concerned about the book, but at the same time, he has to run his country. So when they go to him and they say, these scholars go to him and say, hey, look, we want to translate this Bible and we want to make this Bible into an English Bible up under you. Now they have to go to him and he has to say, okay, you can put this material out there. Or he can say no, but the book's still going to be there because they believe it's a scripture. But now he's authorizing it and saying this is authorized to be published or be a book just overall everywhere, so to speak. And without, you know, hearing anything from the Roman Catholicism or any of them, so to speak. I believe that's how it went about. And I, you know, some other stuff that went a little bit deeper than that between his friction that he had with Rome, you know, about a lot of that stuff.
Okay. You know, I want to backtrack a little bit to when we was talking about the devil and the images of the devil and who can play the devil. And with the story about Jesus being on Mount Sinai being tempted 3 times. By the devil. Was that the devil or was that a devil?
I think that was the devil.
That was the devil. Yeah. So the devil comes in human form too? Or was Jesus talking to some? How would the devil look, I guess?
A spiritual being, so to speak. You know, we know that this energy is there. We don't know how he look. He's not like, he has these red horns or red body with this pitchfork. It's nothing like that.
So if I was, let's say I was there and when this story was happening and I looked up and I saw Jesus on the mountain, I would probably see him by himself, is what you're saying?
No, you would, you know,
if, see somebody,
if you can, if, it depends, if you can view that or see that, then you will see somebody next to him because the spirit realm has an image just as well. We just can't see it. You know, these things are very well there. We just don't perceive it like that because we're limited on what we see. So, for instance, God said in the beginning, he says, let us make man in our image and our likeness. Those Hebrew words are tislam and demut. And when you look at those words and look at the other usages, they use as for images. Like when they say, oh, he made a false image out of gold. The word there is going to be used. The word is going to be used there is more so tislam or demut. So it means it's appearance or shape. So when we would have looked in the spiritual realm, he would have seen somebody. They would have seen somebody with a shape because the spirit realm has a shape. It has a form.
Okay. So you would have seen some type of humanoid shape at least.
Right. At least not probably made of what we see today of this material because as I stated before when we had our talk. Dark matter is 98% of the universe. And dark matter is the cause of the material world that we see now. But we don't know what dark matter is, we just know that it exists there. Now, so, go ahead.
When you talk dark matter, you're digging into science. So do you deal with science and religion at the same time?
Right, I believe that science and religion is cohesive. In other words, you never would have had it to where when you look back in the ancient times where the Egyptians was separating their science from their religion. Matter of fact, they called it alchemy, spiritual alchemy. Because what would happen is this is, if I wanted to know what lies in the immaterial world, then I will have to go and divine to what's immaterial. And when I divine to what's immaterial, that they will give me information on how to move in the material world. This is why we have the so above as so below. Which means, what was below? The Amduat. But what existed in the underworld was dualism. In other words, the principles of nature or Maya existed in the regular world because they had to preserve Maya. Mm-hmm. And also after that, we see in the Amduat, in the Perk M. Heru, we see that these people are being governed or judged by principles of Maya. So they looked at dualism. So these things exist, you know, in the material and also in the physical.
And they, duality.
Right, and they never separated religion from science. They was cohesive because they realized that these scientific things or these phenomena that they experienced, they also seen providence, and they also seen that these things had characteristics. They characterized these things. In other words, these spirit forces had personalities.
Okay.
And that's how they viewed
it. I just picked up on something because, you know what, I do recognize duality, right? I understand the opposites and opposing forces. And I guess that makes a lot of sense that science would be the opposite of religion, but they work together at the same time, you know what I mean? Almost like good and bad.
Right.
You know what I mean? If you don't know bad, you can't know good. You
right,
know, you
right.
You know what I mean? So, yeah, that makes sense to me. Well, what else? Give me something you'd like to tell the people, give the people something, you know?
Yeah, you know, I think that when it comes to the Bible basically deals with man in general. It's for man.
Okay.
You know, it's but it also, it talks about the makeup of man. And the makeup of man is, or the doctrine of man, is he is spirit, soul, and body. In other words, inside of this body is housed a spirit. This body is, in the Hebrew, I mean, the Egyptians would say the body is the ha, you know, and or the house, basically, so to speak. So inside of this body is a spirit man. Mm-hmm. And so it's to that spirit, to that energy is attached a soul. Your spirit is what we look at as your conscience, that, you know, for you to follow instructions, and your soul is that which feels desires, passions, appetites, you know, all of these different things. And so it's attached to your spirit man. Your spirit man doesn't need to eat, but you know, your spirit is attached to a soul. And then your body is basically the shell of that essence. So we gotta look at it that in this world, if we want to survive, and what the Bible teaches, there is politics, there's economics, and there's religion. And so the world is made up of these things. And so if you neglect the doctrine of man, which is the spirit man, then you're going to be led away to those politics, religion. And also, you know, dealing with, you know, when we talk about economics, because what I mean by that is this is, man should not live by bread alone. That's a true statement.
What do you mean by that?
In other words, I'm much more, as I explained, than just a material cause.
I need food.
Right. So if you go and give yourself to the worldly ways of the beast system just because you need food, then you'll do anything for it. You'll betray your brother, you'll betray your mother, you'll betray your wife, you'll betray your kids because you feel that you have to live. Or you'll betray someone just to feed your family. And this is the problem. This is why we call it the beast system. So we can't neglect the other side of us, which is the spirituality. And we have to, that has to be upkept. We can't neglect that. So you consist of not just a material cause, a material flesh. You will have an essence in the side of you. Now, whether you corrupt that essence is another story. So I'm not gonna go kill my brother or go do these other different things because I need to eat. You know what I'm saying? Let alone if we have a disagreement, I shouldn't do that just as well either. So we have to make sure that we are made up of these of material, but not neglect the spirituality just as well. This is, you know, because you are a conscious individual. So so overall, you know, in saying that, it's just like the Bible has tools that we can use, whether it's if you look at it as figurative or if you look at it as literal. You know, I take it to be both. But if you don't take it to be both, at least live by the principles that you see of what's really being conveyed there.
Right.
You know, and then the other part will happen later on.
You'll do this more.
Right. And so all together, you know, people just, I'm just gonna reject the book and this and that. You know, and that's the problem, because we have to establish some type of moral standard. And where did the moral standard come from? You know, what made us person, just according to evolutionary theory, they'll say, this person came from this, he rose up from this ape-like creature, but this ape-like creature was living like this animal. But how did he develop this moral, this morality that they had, to where a person feel a type of way? They love, you know, they hate. So this is consciousness. Consciousness. So right. So we got to look at consciousness is connected to energy. So in order for those things to be in this world, it would have had to been consciousness or conscious force that brought the world into existence, because there's more morality. And we are the product of that. In other words, that's why we have the human experience with love, passion, hate, mercy. You know, how do we know those things? Except that was passed down, and we share that experience just as well.
I'm listening for coming, man. I appreciate it, man. I appreciate it. You know what I mean? This is Ask the Streets Media. We're in the building again with the Brother G Consciousness. The Hebrews is gonna be at you about this Jesus not black thing. We gonna see when we put it out there. It's gonna go down. All right, brother. I appreciate it.
Peace.
If you have questions that you would like to ask the streets, contact us at askthestreetsmedia@gmail.com. Don't forget to subscribe. Hope you liked the video. Thanks for watching.